Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the session 6D. This is the fourth session that we are running on biowaste, waste to energy, wastewater, and faecal sludge management. So we already heard several very good presentations in previous sessions, and now we have finally three more presentations. I see some familiar names here in the list of attendees already, and all of our presenters are here as well. Sola and I will be moderating this session as well. So just like the previous three sessions, so we will be with you and lead a discussion on your presentations. So we will be now playing presentations one by one, 10 minutes for a presentation, and then we have another 10 minutes for Q&A. So we will go with the first presentation.
Good morning, everybody. It is a real pleasure for me today to share with you WASTEWATER Mali experience about monitoring of human rights relating to the management of faecal sludge in the district of Bamako. My name is Moussa Alou Traore. I am Rights, Equity and Inclusion Officer in WASTEWATER Mali. My presentation consists of 9 steps: the introduction, the methodology, the cause of the violation, action initiated by WASTEWATER, action initiated by other actors, violation of human rights, allegedly responsible, possible solution, and inclusion. About the introduction, I can say this report was developed and published by WASTEWATER to contribute to the report for the National Human Rights Commission in Mali in 2019. The aim was to influence decision makers on the urgency of taking action on faecal sludge management. WASTEWATER also published the situation through a television broadcast to increase pressure on decision makers. For the methodology, the following methodology was used: documentation research, analysis of information on faecal sludge management practices, and as well as reports of various studies and documentaries carried out on the subject, visit to the landfill site in the airport area and in Guana in order to collect additional information, organization of working session with local authorities and technical service and other stakeholders in order to validate survey report. About the causes of the violation, we can say lack of specific infrastructure treatment station for management of faecal sludge, the lack of space in the city of Bamako for the construction of a faecal sludge management station, low motivation of amateurs to travel long distance to dump sludge out Bamako, lack of political will, weak application of legislation and regulation in this area, lack of tools for amateurs. For action initiated by WASTEWATER, I can say monitoring of WASH human rights violation, the mobilization awareness raising radio broadcast and social network of communities to claim their water rights, framework for dialogue between citizens and local authorities, advocacy in collaboration with National Human Rights Commission, gender study and the management of faecal sludge, organization of workshop to integrate human rights approach badge into faecal sludge station project. For the actions initiated by other actors, there are mobilization of resources by the state for the construction of the fecal sludge management station from partners, for example, AFD and African Development Bank and so on. Implementation of fecal sludge management station projects in Bamako, Lokalngo, Protos, and European Union, and so on. About violation of human rights, there are violation of health rights through the risk of diseases for women and children, for example, diarrhea, cholera, typhoid fever, and so on. Increase in population health expenditure. There are also violation of right to water and sanitation through contamination of the main source of water supply, well for the population of the village through the flow of washed water from fecal sludge, pollution of the immediate environment of residents. There are also violation of human rights through difficulties for women to access service and older and poor one opportunities, low participation of women, girls in decision-making processes, the risk of violence for women and girls. About allegedly responsible, we can say weak application of the text by authorities in the area of fecal sludge management station, low accountability of authorities at national and local level, weak coordination between stakeholders in the field, application of policies, role by the actor, state, private sector, community, and so on. For the possible solution, there are the effective application of legislative and regulatory texts by actor in the subsector, states, sector, communities, and so on. The coordination of interventions in the field of fecal sludge management station, mobilization of resources for the construction of the fecal sludge management station, for example, financial, human, and space, so what? About the conclusion, the practices described in this report constitute serious human rights violations, including the right to water and sanitation and other related rights. In addition, the national authorities have on several occasions tried to find sustainable solutions to fecal sludge management without concrete action to put an end to these practices. Thank you for your attention. Thank you, everybody. Thank you again.
Okay, so that was presentation by Moussa. So are there any questions from him? Rahul?
No question, sorry.
Okay. Sola, any questions from you?
No, I guess the only thing is if, I don't know if Moussa, I sent you a request. If Moussa, can you hear me, Moussa? I'm not sure. I think we can see you online, but I'm not even sure if you're, can you hear me, Moussa? Traore? I don't think he's, I don't think Moussa is with us actually.
Okay, so if anybody has any questions for him, would you please type your questions so that we can pass them on at later time, or maybe you can join the cafe following the... Oh, Moussa is here.
He's here. Can you hear us? I don't think he can hear us. I mean, we could always catch up on in the cafe. It's just to let you know my interest with respect to your work, because I think it's a very, very important research looking into the violation and of human rights, particularly to women, that has some gender implications. So I think we can move on to the next presentation. Over to you, Tanja.
Okay, yes. So the next presentation is by Osbert. Is that so? Yes. So we'll hear the presentation and then hopefully have a quick discussion.
I'm Osbert at Atwijukye, and I'm presenting a paper on increasing access to safely managed faecal sludge services in underserved urban areas of Uganda. Uganda Sanitation for Health Activity implementing this project is a 5-year project working in about 21 districts of Uganda, with various partners working on different components depending on their expertise. But for faecal sludge management, which is the core for this presentation, we are in 5 districts in northern Uganda, central eastern part of Uganda around Soga area, and then the central Buganda area. In Uganda, access to safe managed and sanitation services for urban areas where we are focusing is still at about 42%. And when you go outside Kampala, the situation is a bit worse. And FSMEs or faecal sludge management entrepreneurs there struggle to offer an affordable yet profitable service. And as a result, they try to cut costs, for example, where they have to empty in very long distances from the treatment plants. They end up trying to dispose illegally in the fields and bushes to cut on the transportation costs in order to make some profit. Unfortunately, some of them do it in ignorance without knowing the impact it causes on the environment. Main objective of this project is increasing access to safe managed sanitation services in underserved urban areas of Uganda. As you know, SID is environmental conscious. They work to protect our environment. Our projects are normally done with an environmental monitoring and mitigation plan. So even for this faecal sludge management services, we want to see it conducted in a way that will be safe for the environment. To do this, adapted a result-driven approach to increase the amount of faecal sludge management services emptied and transported to treatment plants through developing and testing service delivery models for emptying and transportation. Then building capacity of the FSMEs to provide sustainable services. Building the capacity has been both in giving skills and also support, as part of financial support, or supporting them to access financing banks to get equipment which can be able to improve their capacity to do a safe service. Then demand activation through marketing, households, institutions, and other different kinds of customers. Then improving coordination among the FSM stakeholders at district level, ministry, and different entrepreneurs, how they can coordinate better to faecal sludge emptying. There are commonly 3 methods of emptying latrine in Uganda. We have the semi-mechanized ones using galpas. We have cesspool trucks, which are fully mechanized, or vacuum trucks. And we have also manual emptying. But for this project, we are focusing on the tools, the mechanical emptying, using garpas, and also cesspool emptying using the vacuum trucks. Because this, at least you can be sure the contact of people and sludge and also the environment is minimized. So that's why we chose those two to work with. Before we started this implementation, we did a study in the different areas where we went to work, kind of to understand the FSM landscape in these areas, and try to identify different barriers which were affecting safe FSM. We categorize these as customer barriers, barriers which could, our customers included lack of information about safe emptying services, low willingness to pay for the emptying services, then we also had barriers which affect enterprises, such as service delivery models for low volume jobs. For example, in those rural areas, you find these entrepreneurs only focus on big customers like institutions and households cannot get this service because it would be hard for someone to move over 40 kilometers to just empty a small latrine. So some of these were not being, not receiving a service in some areas. And also FSMEs don't do marketing like marketing skills. They just park and wait. Face a lot of underutilization of their resources. We also had contextual barriers, which exist as the nature of the different kinds of behaviors or the level of development in an area, such as inadequate enforcement of sanitation regulations, high prevalence of households in unlined pit latrines, practice of throwing in solid waste in the pit latrines, others could be poor access roads and so on. Then we also had entrepreneurial barriers, things like lack of technical know-how, business skills, lack of existing FSMEs required to provide GARPA services in some areas, because in Uganda we have a lot of weasel pit latrines to match, and some of these are not fit for cesspool emptying, so GARPA's better option, but these were not in some areas. Then also had high cost of purchasing vehicles. Most of the entrepreneurs working with, some of them didn't even have formal banking systems, so could not raise money to buy trucks on themselves. Then significant customer default. Some of them we found some high rates of default where the customer side pay, but they may end up not even paying over a year. Then seasonality of the business, which is also affecting them to retain employees, then failure to account for all the costs like depreciation in their businesses, which makes calculation and business management difficult. So interventions which we put in place to improve all these challenges and make sure we have sustainable services, fecal sludge services, included onboarding FSMEs who are supposed to work with us. So we go in an area, we don't put an advert call, but we just go talk to any entrepreneur who is there. And only those who are willing to meet our conditions are retained and supported. Then we strengthen their business skills through training these FSMEs on standard operational procedures. We developed a lot of tools to help them track their business and also monitor. Then we also provide ongoing business advisory support. We have business specialists on the team who keep meeting these entrepreneurs and guiding them on what it means to run a formal business. In facilitating them to access finance, as we said, most of these we found were either renting trucks, very old trucks at very high costs, which one you find they are not making any business sense. One entrepreneur mentioned that actually when we started contracting business and he saw how much he was spending on maintenance, he said that maybe it was the reason he didn't have money in his account or his pockets. He would not see money yet, he was working a lot. So we tried to help them access finance through partnering with banks, and this case was Opportunity Bank, where we supported two successful truck entrepreneurs to get loans to buy trucks and one Garpa entrepreneur. And we designed grant packages because these cannot borrow as much money as they need for their businesses, so they needed some grant top up. So OSHA trying some grant packages to top up on their vehicle purchases, but also give some monthly business support for a given period of time, which we model until when these entrepreneurs have reached a steady state under which their businesses can continue. This is important because when they adopt these new standard operational procedures, the cost of operation go quite high. So they need to have some kind of support to first get used to the conditions, and then at that level we can pull out and they continue themselves. Then other interventions were trained sales agents who are partnered with the VHTs, VHS teams in these communities to give them guidelines on how to pitch sales for this FSM and link them to the sales book, I mean the pit emptying entrepreneurs who get where the VHTs get jobs, and then interlink with the service providers that offers the services. Total about 45 sales agents who are trained in those areas. Then we developed radio campaigns to where we conceptualize some messages based on the area, and these run for about 3 months in all these areas, and basically to create awareness about these new services and which people will be providing these services. Then follow up on the radio campaigns, design print collateral for these FSMEs, how to continue doing global marketing when they go to empty institutions. Can you put a flyer in that institution or a stick on the latrine? This latrine was emptied by a given entrepreneur on this and this date, such that if someone wants to empty, can visit the latrine and even appreciate what whether they did the work well, and you can make an informed decision whether to call them. Then in order to package our marketing throughout the whole country, we developed a common brand, Clean Pit brand, which has been reserved in Uganda to better package our marketing campaigns. That when we say Clean Pit brand, and someone is in Masaka and in Kitugum, they all understand what Clean Pit brand. So as a result of our interventions, we've seen a significant increase in the number of jobs completed over this 1 year of monitoring despite the lockdowns, because this intervention started in March 2020 and immediately Uganda entered the lockdown. So for example, if you see the first graph for Garpa entrepreneur, the blue is when we before intervened, and the orange is after we intervening. So it's divided into headman months, moderate month, or loadman month. So headman months are like when schools have opened and it's a rainy season, such months have high demand for pit emptying. And loadman months, like it's a dry season, no opening of institutions. So like that, we've seen at least 119% increase in the number of job volume for the Garpa entrepreneur. And for the successful truck entrepreneur, the second graph, the red is after intervening, then the dark blue is before. We saw at least 99% increase in the number of job volumes completed. As we conclude, in the first year, we completed about 380 pitempting jobs, equivalent 3.1 million liters of sludge. And we saw at least three partner FSMEs enter formal banking systems. Thank you.
Okay, so thank you very much for your presentation. Osbert, can you hear us okay? If there are any questions, can you please type them in the chat section or just speak up directly?
Osbert. I think I made Osbert one of the moderators.
Yes, but we lost him for a moment, so I hope that...
Yeah, I think he's back now.
Mm-hmm.
Osbert, can you hear us? Or... Any question for Osbert?
Okay, very bad luck with connection during this session.
Yeah, I think Alberto has a question and Patricia.
Mm-hmm. Osbert, are you with us? Would you be able to take the question?
Hello, am I?
Is that Raul?
Yes.
Oh, Osbert is in the car.
Right, Osbert, thanks for joining us. I presume you're not driving.
He is.
I'm not driving.
Okay, that's fine. I think people want to, are interested in your presentation and want to ask clarification on some questions. I think one of the first question to you is, can you talk more about the sustainability of this venture and GOU? Osbert?
Yes, that's government of Uganda. I request Rahu to take the questions. My network is on and off. Rahu,
you can. Sure. Yeah. Happy to do that. So, Patricia, not sure about the second part about the government of Uganda, what additional details you were looking for, but in terms of the sustainability aspect, so one reason we're trying to work with the private sector to promote sustainable emptying services is that we want these businesses to continue after any kind of project support withdraws. So that thinking has been built into it from the start, whereby we're trying to work with the entrepreneurs through business advisory support to A, build up their skills so that they can understand key business concepts, what they need to take into account when they're looking at their business in terms of, say, if they have to increase jobs, what are the different avenues that they can do it through, who should their target customers be. For example, we know for cesspool emptiers, institutions are their main target market, whereas for gulp emptiers, it tends to be households. So trying to help them understand who their target markets are, how to effectively reach out and market to them, how to set prices, how to control costs. So we're providing ongoing business advisory support to help them develop that understanding. And also through our programmatic support, encourage certain behaviors. For example, Osbert in his presentation mentioned that grants are provided for taking on certain activities that we propose. As part of the grant conditions, there are certain aspects. For example, you have to dispose the sludge safely. You have to increase over time your spend on marketing. Because one key gap, for example, we saw is that entrepreneurs in Uganda were not interested in spending on marketing their services. So they were waiting. For example, if you have a cesspool truck, you park the truck at a intersection and wait for business to come to you. Like people see your truck and come up and approach you, but they weren't actively going out and marketing their services. So we said, no, you know, you need to engage in sorry, just there seems to be a problem with video as well. What we wanted was people to start seeing the value in going out and actually looking for work, not just waiting for work to come to them. So part of the grant conditions we have is that over time they need to increase their spend in marketing to a certain proportion of revenue. So through measures such as that, we've been trying to build sustainability into the model and into the way the entrepreneurs work. So I'll just stop there and see if there are any follow-up questions regarding that. Patricia, also, if you can clarify what you wanted to know about the government in Uganda, happy to answer that as well.
While we wait for Patricia to clarify that, I think Alberta's got a question. Can we know more about the business advisory and what does it include?
Sure. So thanks for the question, Alberto. So as I was saying, some of the business advisory aspects I've spoken about when responding to Patricia, but to maybe take a step back and look at it. What we're trying to do, like I said, is build sustainable businesses. So the first step we did was not just identify barriers to provision of FSM in Uganda as a whole, but also looked at the P&Ls of these specific businesses that we partnered with. So we looked at their existing profit and loss and identified gaps in their businesses or areas that needed to be strengthened. For example, some businesses had very high levels of bad debts. So while they would go out and get jobs and they would give them on credit and then they wouldn't end up getting the money back. Others had challenges where, for example, they had very high administrative costs. So whatever money they were making were getting eaten up by those costs. So what we're trying to do is, on a month-by-month basis, help them analyze their profit and loss account, understand what revenues come in, what their costs have been, and show them where they can try and optimize their businesses. In fact, just earlier today, we were having a conversation with one of our partners on how they need to cut down the admin costs because they need to, is eating away all their profit. So one way of doing that was to show them that for their level of utilization, given their current cost structure, they would actually need to be pricing their service at a level that is unsustainable. So if they want to continue pricing at a level that is sustainable, they need to manage costs. So to explain those kind of trade-offs and how basically their costs are getting reflected in their price. So it's the whole gamut of that. So we're basically doing ongoing advisory support in terms of whatever existing challenges we'd identified at the start and any new challenges that evolve as we go, to kind of help them think through their business more systematically.
Thank you very much, Rahul. No, I hope that answers Alberto's question. He is pleased. Yes. Any other questions?
Can I clarify on the sustainability thing?
Yes, please.
Yes. So previously, like, this support of cesspool trucks and trucks has been given to government of Uganda, but when you go to most districts or municipalities, you find most of these cesspool trucks are parked when they get a small issue. So that's why we chose to go to the private people, support the private people, and then on add on the support Rahul has mentioned. So we think in that way it will be more sustainable other than just giving trucks to municipalities and local government, and when they get a smaller issue, they're just parked. So that service cannot be sustainable. So we opted to go for private people and train them, give them best practices for their businesses to make sure they can be sustainable even after we pulled out. Thank you.
Thanks for that clarification.
Thanks for the clarification, yeah. I think we have a question from Moussa Alou Traore. I think Moussa is really interested in the major difficulties you faced and what were the solutions or interventions you've deployed.
Sure. Thanks, Moussa. And so, Osbert, sorry, were you responding? Would you like me to go ahead? Okay, perhaps I can
go ahead,
start.
Rahul, go ahead.
Sure. So that's a great question. And I think if Moussa, you remember the slide that Osbert presented, that blue colored slide, which had a number of challenges called out around it. So when we were getting into this, we actually identified a number of barriers that were preventing sustainable FSM businesses from operating in Uganda, not all of which we could address. So for example, one major contextual barrier that we come up against is the fact that you have a lot of unlined pit latrines, which have high solid waste content. Now, this affects FSM businesses in two ways. One, it makes one service untenable, like cesspool truck, because when in unlined pits, the sludge tends to be quite viscous, very thick. So the cesspool trucks have a problem pumping it out, and the solid waste in it ends up clogging their systems. So if they were to work on pits like that, they need to first manually empty solid waste using pumps, then add water, then empty it. So it increases the time a lot, it reduces the number of jobs they can do, increases costs, right? That's when they can empty it. Often with unlined pits, they also just collapse with the pressure of the cesspool trucks. So it makes it untenable. The gulper service is something that can be used for such pits. But again, the time and cost involved in emptying pits which have a lot of solid waste limits the number of jobs that the entrepreneurs can take on. So this is a contextual barrier that really affects utilization and affects the ability of entrepreneurs to deliver jobs at an affordable rate. But it's something we can't solve as a project because it would require years to change. Like, you need people to start building toilets with lined pits. They're not going to do that until their current toilet becomes unusable. So it's a very long-term change. Still, we're trying to work with the government, district local government, to have sensitization meetings around this, to convince people to build solid pits. But that is a smaller proportion of what we're doing. Where we're trying to focus our energy is on the businesses themselves and solve barriers that the businesses are facing, like in their operations. For example, like mentioned, one key barrier we saw to, that was leading to low utilization is the either lack of marketing skills or the lack of desire to market their services. Like I said, there was a very passive approach to marketing that we came across, where people were waiting for jobs to come to them. Or at most, they would go around and distribute visiting cards. So what we found from experience of working in other countries and studying many other market-based sanitation projects is that direct sales, door-to-door sales agents, is something that really increases demand for FSM services or activates existing demand for FSM services. So we worked with the local governments to identify appropriate sales agents who ended up being community health workers. We designed tailored sales pitches for these sales agents to use. So tailored the message on why we should take FSM. And unlike, say, public health approaches where the focus would be on health, like, you know, you should empty your toilet because, you know, it'll help prevent diseases or dispose the sludge safely because it'll help promote diseases. We try to anchor the messaging to aspects that the customers would care about. For example, the cleanliness of the service or the fact that the sludge isn't buried so in their property, which is something that customers do want. So we try to identify key parameters that would appeal to a customer from a marketing point of view, the features and attributes of the service that are desirable, and train the sales agents on how to deliver that sales pitch, and then have them go out into the community and make these pitches. Similarly, we also launched a radio campaign that was then in Osbert's presentation, where we kind of tried to, again, clear up the same features and attributes of the service rather than the health message. And the radio campaign in particular has had a lot of positive response. Entrepreneurs are very happy with it. But marketing was one key aspect. Another aspect we worked with them on was standard operating procedures. For example, one major challenge these businesses face is that because vehicles are so expensive in Uganda, vehicles are either rented or they buy secondhand vehicles, which break down very soon. Some of these cesspool trucks are 20 years old when the entrepreneur gets them, right? So they're past the usable life, but that's the only vehicles they can afford. So what we've done is like to try and bring in a standard operating procedure around vehicle maintenance and servicing to ensure regular servicing and regular maintenance. That might increase the monthly servicing cost, but would reduce the cost on major repairs and mechanical failures, right? Reduce the downtime of the truck as well, allow you to do more jobs. So we brought in standard operating procedures for that. We also assisted a couple of entrepreneurs in purchasing their own vehicle because we realized that the rental costs are also very high. So that involved working with banks to kind of arrive at more favorable loan products. So interest rates typically are very high in Uganda. It could go as high as 36% per annum for some of these loans. So we tried to work with banks to provide a more favorable loan product at around 24-28% of interest and subsidize the cost of the truck a bit to make sure that the entrepreneur could take a loan at a 24% interest rate and still service the monthly payments from the business. So that was a long drawn out process and something actually we're very proud of because a lot of these entrepreneurs were not even, didn't even have registered businesses. Forget being having access to formal banking. So through the partnership, we managed to register their businesses, get them access to formal banking, get them a loan. And these aren't loans that are guaranteed in any way by the project. We've provided some amount of upfront capital, but we've not guaranteed the loan in any way. What we managed to do is present financial projections to the bank, show them that these businesses can be profitable if they reach a business scale. And through those conversations, arrived at a better balance of loan terms that the entrepreneur is comfortable with. So those are some of the key challenges and how we address them. There are many, many more, but I think marketing and capital are the two ones that I would particularly like to highlight.
Thank you very much, Rahul, for your very detailed answer. We have another question for you, but I'm afraid we'll have to move on because we are slightly behind schedule. Mahima is actually the next presenter. So once when we finish with your presentation, Mahima, if there is later time, you can ask your question or you can take that question to the cafe following this session. So we will go to the next presentation now.
Hello, I am Anika Maji from the Indian Institute for Human Settlements, and I'm working with Tamil Nadu Urban Sanitation Support Program. To tell you a bit about TNUSSP, it is the Technical Support Unit to the State Government of Tamil Nadu. Currently, it is supporting the government to improve urban sanitation and scale FSM across 663 towns. So the program was launched in 2015 and is being funded by Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. Today, my colleague Srinathi Sudhakar and I will present about the existing desludging service model in Tamil Nadu and the regulated desludging model being adopted to help bring improvements such as increase in access to treatment facilities and reduction in financial barriers to safe disposal. To give you more context, Tamil Nadu is a state in south of India with an urban population of 31 million. Taking into account the urbanization in the state, the government recognized that in addition to sewerage services, FSM was required to ensure full coverage of sanitation services. So with this aim, in 2018, TNUSSP supported the government to frame state investment plan to scale treatment facilities in 5 phases. Aside from scaling, TNUSSP is also working on sustaining FSM operations through multiple other interventions such as capacity building and stakeholder engagement and various other activities. To give you an insight into the urbanization structure in Tamil Nadu, here, urban areas or the urban local bodies can be categorized into municipal corporations, municipalities, and town panchayats. The ULBs are categorized into 3 tiers mainly based on population sizes. While corporations house the largest population, town panchayats are smaller areas with lesser population. So within these urban areas, 70% of households are connected to on-site sanitation systems. Currently, this large percentage of urban households rely on desludging services provided by a market of private desludging operators that is largely unregulated. This market mainly provides on-demand desludging services, and there is no standard desludging because the desludging frequency differs from customer to customer due to large variance in containment sizes and types. So what we know from our studies is that current desludging services are provided by a vibrant informal market. And some of the characteristics of these desludging businesses include that they're largely male dominated, and this occupation is often caste based. Also, these are mainly small businesses where owners of desludging vehicles sometimes double up as operators or drivers and even workers. Therefore, it is an unregulated and informal market. Moving on to the challenges with the existing model, the operators face many challenges with the current service model. For instance, due to lack of treatment facilities at reasonable distances, the operators end up practicing unsafe disposal and also incur a huge transportation cost. In the current model, the urban poor are not able to access these services due to issues of affordability and physical access. Therefore, to overcome the challenges mentioned, TNUSSP proposed a regulated desludging model based on on-demand desludging services with the objective to provide treatment facilities within reasonable distance and remove any financial barriers to safe disposal while promoting sanitation worker safety and inclusive desludging services. To achieve these objectives mentioned, a number of steps were taken that will be explained by my colleague Srinathi.
Thanks, Anika. So next, in terms of ensuring safe disposal, creation of adequate treatment facilities was recognized as a critical first step, and a state investment plan was developed for scaling of treatment facilities based on a cluster approach. Under this cluster approach, the urban local bodies falling within 10 kilometer radius of the existing or upcoming treatment facilities were clustered together to share the treatment facility. The regulated desludging model, which we will be proposing, leverages on this cluster approach. This clustering approach was operationalized through a government order MOU, and this MOU governed the operation and maintenance of the shared treatment facilities and also assigned responsibility to the cluster ULBs to ensure that all desludging operators within their cluster jurisdiction are licensed and also dispose of fecal sludge at the designated shared treatment facility. Next, as part of the government order, the state also issued a standard licensing agreement or SLA to streamline the collection, disposal and operation of desludging operators. So through this licensing agreement, the desludging operators are mandated to license their vehicle with their respective local bodies and also utilize the designated treatment facilities falling within their cluster. So to ensure utilizations, vehicles, that is the desludging vehicles, are to be fitted with GPS devices, which had to be monitored and tracked by urban local bodies to prevent open dumping and also to finally ensure safe disposal. The additional features of this licensing agreement mandates that all operators undertake periodic health checkups and also ensure safety training for their employees. Another important feature of this license is that while it collects a license fee and also a tipping fee, the rates for these are kept very nominal so as not to disincentivize these operators. Additionally, since the market rates of for these desludging services are mostly competitive, there is no price intervention or price ceiling introduced by the government. These features ensure that the livelihood options for the operators are not disrupted. The standard licensing agreement as part of the regulated desludging model is being implemented at scale across Tamil Nadu through capacity building modules of webinars, digital blended learning methods and also on-field roving support. Next slide talks about inclusive services, which is very important, and the program is exploring new desludging models in ULBs without sufficient private players to ensure that all households can access competitively priced desludging services. Some of the models under exploration will ensure that desludging operators, along with government support, can cater to difficult terrain such as hilly areas, bulk generators, and also informal settlements at subsidized desludging rates. Next, in terms of learning from this regulated desludging model, is that one, the cluster approach has ensured that desludging operators have access at reasonable distances to adequate treatment facilities. And two, the light touch regulation with no price intervention ensures that the livelihoods of the desludging operators face no disruptions. Through this model, we have also understood that private operators can be assigned additional roles of safety and providing inclusive services with minimal government support. Many urban and rural areas at present face the issue of varying containment sizes where desludging frequency cannot be standardized, and this model can be replicated in these regions with adequate private operators providing on-demand desludging services. The government can also be supportive to scaling of desludging enterprises in other locations by limiting to light touch regulation and not introducing any price ceiling, which will affect the market desludging rates. This would additionally be helpful for reducing the government's burden of direct provisioning. Finally, by adopting a cluster model for provisioning of shared treatment facilities and by efficiently leveraging and supporting the private desludging market, this model can be easily scaled up across both rural as well as urban areas. Thank you. We welcome any questions and suggestions. You can also visit our website, TNUS.
So do we have any questions for our authors? Can you hear us okay?
Yes, I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Okay.
I think someone is trying to type a question, but
maybe it's easier just to speak up.
Sorry?
Maybe just easier for them to speak rather than type a question.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think that's come up.
Okay. So what type of treatment facility is being recommended?
So we have in Tamil Nadu proposed the faecal sludge treatment plants, which are biological plants, non-mechanical plants, gravity-based systems that have been scaled across the state. And what we've proposed is of different capacities. So we don't have a standard capacity. We've developed three.
Oh, I think we lost Mahima there.
Srinita,
can you?
Yes.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, so yeah, just to continue with what Mahima is telling, yes, it's a gravity-based systems. And the reason we have suggested these systems is because the government officers or the urban local bodies will be easily able to maintain these systems. That was one of the key purposes why we looked for, you know, doing like very simple systems. And like Mahima told, there were different sizes proposed, because we didn't at the start really wanted to create a very big treatment facility and then not get the loads, sufficient loads. So based on the population, we tried to keep it different sizes based on the population. And then if based on the demand, based on the loads which come, there was a provision for expanding these treatment systems. So yeah, basically it's a biological system, gravity-based biological system. I hope that answers the question.
Right, thanks. I think there is a question, or more like a comment here from Rahul.
Rahul, do you want to just join in? And
I think, Rahul, you could just summarize your comments. It doesn't look like a question to me. So if you can hear.
Sorry, I was just replying in chat to Mahima's question from earlier. as per your suggestion.
So Mahima, from your previous session, okay. Any question for Sriniti and Mahima? I guess one question that pops up for me from your presentation is I just want to find out why the market is male populated. Is that, are there some financial barriers hampers women or female from entering into the market?
Yeah. So yeah, just answering to your question, yes, in Tamil Nadu, we do work in some model locations. Example, one place by name Trichapalli, we work very closely out there. Yeah, largely it is a male-dominated sector. But right now we do have women desludging operators entering the business. And through our program, we are trying to support these people because we would encourage more women desludging operators to get into this business. But there are challenges faced for women desludging operators getting into this business. But largely it is male dominated. And for example, some of the challenges that we have heard from women desludging operators, which I can quickly tell, is like, for example, like driving the vehicle is something which they are not used to. These heavy big vehicles or something, and climb, these are huge vehicles, so for them to climb, and the type of personal protective equipment are not customized for women. So all these type of challenges the few women desludging operators who are in the field are facing. And we are working with them to, like, you know, support them in terms of, you know, bringing more awareness or in terms of providing equipment and all that. But yeah, it's a male-dominated field, I would say, largely.
Do you, I think there are two questions. Thank you very much for the answer. I think there are two questions here. The first one from Patricia. They said, what is the survival of FSM enterprises, roughly? Female businesses, percentage eight, what is the rough, in your estimation, the rough survival rates of FSM enterprises in Tamil Nadu?
Okay. So in certain places, it is good in terms of there is a mixed thing. That is, even whether there are sewer or underground sewerage systems, still there is a decent market for these desludging operators as well. So there are cases where it's a mixed network system as well as happening. And yeah, obviously, in terms of when there is an expansion for network systems, there has been a problem where operators are thinking of what are the alternate opportunities. And one of the ways that they are thinking is like expanding the business, like, you know, going to nearby towns or, you know, expanding the business, but that would actually add additional cost for them. That is a major problem. Like, if they feel that their town is going to get sewered in the next few years in terms of underground sewerage is going to come, what they suggest is they move to outer areas, smaller towns and all that, but it's still serviced by on-site sanitation systems, and they pick it up. So right now, it is a thriving business. And in terms of Tamil Nadu, they have good desludging trucks and also like good quality desludging trucks. So in terms of Tamil Nadu, it is a good business where people like invest quite an amount and they work on it. And in terms of female business, the people who we see take up these desludging operators are usually people that they've seen their fathers or brothers in the business, and then they take over it after some time. So that is the most common we have seen. It's very rare that new women step into it. It's like when they see their counterparts, mostly family members, relatives in the business, then they have the confidence to get into this business as well. So that's how we see female. And in terms of age, it's, average like 30, 40 years. I mean, we've seen just few female entrepreneurs, but yeah, that's the thing.
Thank you very much, Riniti. Any question? Any other question?
I have a question, please.
Yes, please.
All right, thank you. I will just listen to the presentation, but again, I have mixed it a bit from your presentation because I've got poor network on my side. For the disposal and treatment of the fecal sludge, I don't know, based on your study, do you identify private sector individuals who are involved in the management of Faecal Sludge, I mean, like the treatment.
Sorry, I didn't quite catch that question. Yeah.
Same here. I wasn't, it's not, can it be repeated or type any of us without? Mahima is also back.
So yeah.
Oshulali, if you can repeat your question or type it, we didn't catch it.
All right, so let me try it again. For the disposal of the Faecal Sludge and the treatment, do you have private sectors, individuals involved in that sector?
Sorry, are you asking if there are private people managing treatment facilities? Is that the question?
Yes.
So while the treatment facilities themselves are being implemented by the governments, the state government and the local urban local bodies, we are looking to engage the private sector in the operation and maintenance of these treatment facilities. So it's not that these treatment facilities are being set up by the private sector, but they are potentially going to be involved in running these facilities once they're operational and have been commissioned. And with the ones that are currently operational, it's a similar case where we've got either maybe an NGO running the facility, or some sanitation workers were employed in the urban local body itself. Does that answer your question?
Yes, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Mahima. Yes, thank you very much. I'm very conscious about the time because we're just now 1 minute over, and I worry that this may close by itself. So yes, before that happens, I would just like to thank all of our presenters for this session. It was another very interesting session for all of us. And to thank to all attendees developing discussion and for providing some constructive feedback on the research which was presented. So thank you all.